Just two caveats. First of all, I'm not one of the 8% of people who think myself as being expert in EAP. So I'm a little uncomfortable with the whole title of this day, I must admit. Also, I'm only here because one of my colleagues has laryngitis. I didn't sign myself as being one of the two best people for this job. Anyway, I want to talk quite briefly, because there is only 7 minutes, about two themes that I like to concentrate on when I'm developing material. And I was hoping to pick two that might not just be exactly the same ones that everyone would obviously want to focus on. So the first one is what I've called data-driven language syllabus. I put that in quotation marks because I think it's slightly pompous phrase for this context. When I say data-driven, I don't mean I have deeply analyzed various corpora and come up with a language syllabus on that basis. What I mean is others have done so, and I have read their journal articles about it. So the data was involved, but I didn't generate the data. The other one is what I've called oblique ways to introduce course elements, and you'll see what that means quite soon. I've taken here a photo of a fairly, from a fairly typical EAP grammar text. And as you can see, the very first unit in this text is revision of all the tenses. When we use the present simple, the present continuous, past simple, past continuous, past perfect, and what looks pretty clearly to be a text made up for the purpose of including all those verb forms. We've got examples here of past continuous, past perfect, and so on. And I had to do an assignment a few years ago which involved interviewing my colleagues and saying, what do you think is the most central thing in grammar teaching? And unsurprisingly, because the whole industry seems to have decided this, it's the verb system. And the problem with that is these next few slides, by the way, come from the Bali website, someone else's previous presentation, so I'm taking advantage of their typing and formatting. And so on. Use of continuous ing forms and use of perfect forms. Far smaller in academic writing than in conversation, fiction, or journalistic writing. And one more. Past and present continuous. Much less common in academic writing than most other registers. And so as a result, partly followed this principle as spelled out by Edward Chazal in his 2014 book on English writing purposes. And I'm letting the texts tell you what language features are important. But of course, you can't really do that. If your coursework is going to include 10 texts, that's not enough to be going on. So also, whenever designing the kind of language elements of course material, draw on books like these. This one by Ellie Hinkle, which itself draws very, very heavily on the long grammar. Other people include Hyland, Swales and Feek, Tomlinson. I could give you a longer list, but I see I have 2 minutes left. So as a result, we focus in our EAP 1 course on nominalization as partly a way to get away from the over-personalized nature of language students might tend to use. Like a lot of EAP courses, we do talk about hedging and its various manifestations and for various reasons. Talk about using those kind of, I mean, they're sometimes called general nouns, synoptic nouns, catch-all nouns, enumerative nouns, things like cause, effect, words and phrases used to cite sources. We draw attention to the AWL, have students run their papers through websites to see, you know, how much formal language are they using, whether AWL or not, but more to the point, maybe how much simple language or informal language are they using. Then very, very quickly, the second element has to do with ways to kind of get at something, almost, if you will, trick the students into doing what we need them to do. So here, for example, it's a bit small, depending how far you are away from a screen. We have a course in which students have to do research interviews, they kind of in-depth semi-structured interviews to get their data from companies or whoever. So imaginary question, asking teachers, how do you use computers when you're teaching? And then students have to look at those six answers, decide which of those teachers they think they would like to study with, which they would not. Then they have to try to analyze all the teachers' answers into groups. And so I let them sit and do that for 10 minutes. And then at the end, reveal that the whole thing was a big trick. And then in fact, not one single person of those six answered the question, how do you use computers in your teaching? And that's a way of introducing the idea that if you're interviewing someone and their answer is irrelevant or vague or incomprehensible, then it's your job to go and ask more questions. But I find that this kind of way of tricking them into learning something can sometimes be effective. An example of why summary writing is important. And I find just, you know, if you can kind of raise a laugh, rather than saying, it's very important to be able to write summaries in order to complete your academic assignments. You know, just kind of being a little bit lighthearted is sometimes, I find, a useful way to get students started. I've gone over time already. The slides are going to be available. Basically, this is the idea of day-to-day conversation. Either they often exaggerate it, whereas academic writing needs to be either precise or else hedged. Here, day-to-day conversation, exactly the opposite of either of those two things. I have already run over, how shameful. The slides are available.